everybody. So this week is going to be a filler week. So as you guys know, soon we are going to reach the end of the alphabet of the UN countries. 6 years I've been doing this channel, I'm still not done. Anyway, as you guys know, some of the countries at the end of the alphabet of UN countries are in the smallest continental region on Earth, both in population and in land size. I'm talking about Oceania. I've heard it pronounced other ways, Oceania, Oceania, but the one I've heard the most is Oceania, so I'm gonna call it that. Now, in certain areas of the world, you will learn that there are 7 continents. Some areas teach that there are only 6 continents, but the point being is that nobody really knows exactly what to label this whole area. Oceania is the word used to generally encompass everything that's not Asia, but it's in the Pacific as well as Australia and New Zealand. Some people consider all of it a continent. Some people just consider Australasia a continent. It depends on who you ask. If you ask me, I just kind of clump it all together. But again, it depends on who you ask. Anyway, today's video is Oceania Explained. And before we get into it, this video is sponsored by Cetera. You guys know that I'm very strict on who I choose to promote on this channel. And Cetera obviously makes a lot of sense because they are a geography learning website. Like, you can play geography games on their website. Really fun stuff. Totally recommend it. Check out Cetera. Thank you, Cetera. Oh, and while I'm at it, don't forget to get your Geography Now t-shirts, Geography Now gym sacks, and Geography Now coffee mugs at geographynow.com. Blah, blah, blah. You've heard this spiel before. It's my merch. I can promote it. Anyway, Oceania. The entire population of all of Oceania is only about 43-ish million people as of 2020. It spans the eastern and western hemispheres, crossing over the international date line, and the boundaries are very blurred. A lot of people don't exactly even know what even classifies, but the furthest islands that people might claim would be the Northern Mariana Islands for the northwest. Some might extend it to the Bonin Islands of Japan, Hawaii in the northeast, but some might extend it to Clipperton Island, Easter Island in the southeast, although some might extend it to the Juan Fernandez Islands, and New Zealand in the south, but some extend it to Macquarie Island just below, which belongs to Australia. In Oceania, you have 4 subregions that divide up the islands both culturally and geographically. They are Australasia, Melanesia, Micronesia, and Polynesia. Although, of course, there are no actual demarcated lines in the ocean. Generally, the ocean boundaries kind of look like a pair of lips kissing a triangle, and we will cover these 4 regions now. Australasia, the biggest one, made up of pretty much almost everything that belongs to Australia and New Zealand. Keep in mind the Cocos and Keeling and Christmas Island territories are in the Indian Ocean, not the Pacific, but their classification depends on whom you ask. Anyway, obviously, Australia is the largest and most populated one, with about half of the entire population of Oceania. Australia is the only landmass that is able to harbor extensive desert zones and desert flora and fauna. As the biggest economy and trading partner and social influencer, they are essentially kind of like the factory that keeps things going on with all the other nations in the Pacific. Without Australia, it's a strong case to argue that many of the other Pacific islands would struggle to maintain their growing development needs. And it's confusing because New Zealand is kind of the only landmass that is both part of Australasia and Polynesia, as the native Maori people of New Zealand are considered the southernmost Polynesians in the world. But yeah, for what it's worth, Australia and New Zealand, they're the powerhouses of Oceania. I mean, there's not too much I could say that you guys don't already know. I mean, Australian, New Zealand culture, I kind of see Aussies and Kiwis as just like these joyfully intrepid, adventurous people. You gotta love the Aussies and Kiwis. You know, Australia is kind of like the girlfriend that the US cheats on Canada with, but then Canada also kind of secretly cheats on the US with New Zealand. So it's kind of like we're stuck in this love square. Anyway, jumping off of New Zealand, Polynesia. Polynesia has the largest ocean territory in the Pacific, and the entirety of the population is only around 6 to 6.5-ish million people, depending on who you include. Out of all the native peoples of Oceania, Polynesians kind of get like the most attention in media. I mean, everybody knows like the hula, luau's, the haka dance, tribal tattoos, the Easter Island statues. Those are all kind of like distinct Polynesian culture traits. Whenever there's like a movie or a TV show featuring an islander, it's almost always exclusively a Polynesian. In Polynesia, you have the core island groups of the sovereign nations of New Zealand, Samoa, Tonga, and Tuvalu, Hawaii, which is a state of the US, and American Samoa, which is a US territory, the New Zealand Free Association states of the Cook Islands, Niue and Tokelau, Easter Island, which is a special territory of Chile, all of French Polynesia, which is an overseas territory of France, as well as Wallace and Futuna, which is classified as a collectivity of France. There's also Norfolk Island, which is an external territory of Australia, the Pitcairn Islands, which are British overseas territories, and finally Rotuma, which actually belongs to the Melanesian nation of Fiji, but is geographically and culturally classified as falling under Polynesian. There's also a bunch of disputed areas, like the Line Islands of Kiribati are kind of classified as Polynesian. And Nauru is kind of a disputed one because their culture is kind of mixed between Micronesian and Polynesian. It's weird. But basically what you gotta know is that in the Pacific, there is the Polynesian Triangle. It starts in New Zealand, goes up to Hawaii, ends in Easter Island, and it just makes a triangle. I would kind of argue that Polynesians are probably some of the most adventurous, intrepid, spirited people on Earth because their ancestors literally had to cross the Pacific with minimal seafaring technology. The Polynesians also took claim to their territory very seriously, as having land in the middle of the ocean was seen as very important. The bigger the land, the better. But the issue is, a lot of the islands were just very far apart from each other. So that's why their culture kind of developed a lot of big, strong, warrior types of people. They really wanted to defend their islands. I mean, if you had a tropical paradise, you'd probably want to defend it too. Families and cousins would split off, and that's kind of where you get the different Polynesian languages. A lot of them are intelligible, but they still have their own, like, little dialects. You know, Cook Islanders can kind of understand the Maori. You know, people of Samoa kind of understand the Tongans, like that. But yeah, they developed really strong kingdoms and civilizations that were thriving. So anyway, yeah, moving on. Micronesia. Not to be confused with the Federated States of Micronesia, a country inside of Micronesia called Micronesia. Anyway, this is the smallest in terms of population and land area. They have less than 500,000 people and less than 1,000 square miles of land. The difference between Micronesia and Polynesia, first of all, is that, like the name implies, it is micro. It's very small. Unlike Polynesia and Melanesia, most of their landmass are coral atolls, these thin, wispy, flat, low-lying islands that barely go above sea level. In the region of Micronesia, you have the sovereign states of Palau, the Federated States of Micronesia, and the Marshall Islands, as well as Kiribati and Nauru, although Nauru is kind of disputed. And then you have the US territories of Guam and the Northern Mariana Islands. One trait politically that sets this area apart is that most of the islands in this area have some kind of alignment with US policy. Palau, the Federated States of Micronesia, and the Marshall Islands are all US free association states, which means they kind of give each other a certain level of privilege. The people from the island countries are easily able to move and migrate to the US and live there, buy property, and vice versa, US to these islands. In addition, they also have access to certain US social services. In addition, they provide the US with military bases. That's kind of how it works. Kiribati and Nauru are kind of more aligned with Australia, and they work more with the Australian government, and they're kind of more on their own. And Kiribati is the only nation that has a plus 14 UTC time zone. They straddle the international dateline, so they are technically the first country to see tomorrow. Again, we did videos on these. If you didn't watch them, watch them. Anyway, culturally, Micronesians have kind of had to adapt to surviving off of as little land space and resources as possible. They didn't exactly quite have the warlike culture as the Polynesians, although they could fight and they had these really cool helmets made out of blowfish. But overall, they just weren't really involved in too many tribal wars because they didn't really have a lot of space to ambush on. Usually the more elevated and larger islands with space and hills, they provided crops that would be traded with the atolls that didn't have enough space to grow them. So there was a lot of trading going on between Micronesians, and they kind of relatively got along well with their neighbors and traded well. This allowed the unique Micronesian cultures and traditions to flourish. Stone was a very prized commodity. So Yap was a very popular island in Micronesia, and there were a lot of quarries in Yap, and they would actually make the rye stones, which are the world's largest currency. Still technically kind of used today, just big circular discs. The more stone you had, the more powerful you were in Micronesia. Anyway, over time, they got a lot of influence from the Spanish and the Philippines, as Guam was once a Spanish colony, and then a lot of Filipinos moved in. But yeah, Micronesia, it's easy to memorize that it's the micro part of Oceania. It's the smallest one. And finally, Melanesia, the second most populated region of Oceania with about 12-ish million people. It is made up of the island of New Guinea, split between Indonesia and Papua New Guinea, as well as the nations of Fiji, Vanuatu, the Solomon Islands, and some will say maybe East Timor. In addition, you have the French Overseas Collectivity of New Caledonia. Melanesians are probably the most enigmatic people group on Earth, with traits and customs that are probably the least highlighted out of all the others. For one, it is the most linguistically diverse area on Earth. Papua New Guinea alone has over 800 recognized languages. It's almost like every single people group and island has their own language or dialect of another cousin language, but essentially it's broken down to people that speak either Austronesian or Papuan languages. Long story short, Melanesians are the cousins of the native Aboriginal peoples of Australia. Some argue that the Torres Strait Islanders might be considered Melanesian, but some people don't. They say they're native. No, it's native Aboriginal. Up to them to decide. I don't know. Ethnic Melanesians are generally darker in their complexion and have coarse hair, which is why often they can be mistaken for being black or of African descent, which they are not related to. Modern geneticists are actually kind of baffled and have theories as to where their ancestors actually came from. But the general consensus is maybe somewhere in South Asia, whereas the Polynesians and Micronesians were mostly descended from East Asia. Melanesians are also the only darker shade skinned people on Earth to have natural blonde hair, a trait caused by the TYRP1 gene. Sometimes it might come out as reddish or bright brown. In any case, geographically, Melanesians have some of the most volcanic land on Earth. Eruptions and lava flows are almost daily occurrences in some areas. Most areas are lush and green with intense biodiversity, but at the same time, very deadly as well. Therefore, the inhabitants have kind of learned how to adapt and survive in a land of chaotic wonder. Traditionally, many Melanesians didn't build towns, but rather like temporary, tight-knit, well-hidden settlements to avoid ambush from other tribes. More so than the Polynesians, I would argue, Melanesians were kind of more willfully distant from other Melanesians, which is one of the reasons why you probably get so many languages and customs and rituals amongst them. Each small group kept to their own ways and hid it from all the other ones. I mean, in Papua New Guinea alone, you have like the Baining people with the fire dance. The men of the Huli tribe have yellow face paint and wear feather hats during celebrations. The Trobriand Islands have their weird cricket fusion octopus dance game. Certain Solomon Islanders have cool beaded headdresses, and Vanuatans invented bungee jumping with people jumping off incredibly dangerous platforms with tree vines. It's honestly like shocking that Melanesian culture isn't really highlighted much in media when it's so like colorful, unique, vibrant, and fascinating. I don't know, maybe Moana should have been Melanesian. So yeah, that's just about it. Just a very quick general summary of the regions of Oceania. Each island has their own cool little thing going on. It's considered the last human inhabited area on Earth, and it's a very special region of the planet that not too many people pay attention to. But you, just watching this video, did pay attention to it, so good for you. Anywho, one last shout out, get a Geography Now t-shirt at geographynow.com and a Geography Now mug and a Geography Now drawstring bag, whatever you want, at geographynow.com. All right, stay tuned. I'm gonna work on the next episodes. Have a good one.